Let's talk about white supremacy, the stubbornness of white supremacy. It plays out in Buffalo this weekend.
Yes, it did.
Your thoughts, please.
Well, one of the things that I wanted to talk about is that there has been an increase in the prevalence of the utility of the term white supremacy to explain the day-to-day, again, a fancy word we use is quotidian, which is the normal roundabout way in which Black people interface with the ways institutional and social mechanisms affect their lives in American society. And my goal here in this conversation is not to deny the fact that there is a racialized aspect to the way in which Black, brown, or even a sexualized way in which women or gendered way in which people of sexual orientation interface with structural mechanisms in our society. But what my point I'm trying to say is that what happened in Buffalo is clearly a case of white supremacy, in that the modus that motivated the actor, the killer, the assailant in that case was an antagonism towards brown people, and that he wished death upon them, and that there was a sick, rather almost evil-like hatred and contempt he had for them that motivated his actions. There are segments, large segments of American society that are motivated by that type of contempt. And yes, there have even been institutions in American society, particularly throughout the 19th century and slavery, that have been motivated by that contempt. My position is that American society does not have to have that level of racialized contempt to actually implement the harms that it does on otherwise communities, racialized or other, because within the system of capitalism, the demand and requirement to have a surplus faction of the society rendered to obsolescence requires that that carnage be visited upon those institutional members of society that are left out, and that it does not require something as metaphysical as white supremacy to be as quotidianly oppressive and harmful. And a perfect example that I shared with your producer is gentrification. Oftentimes, people will say that gentrification is a manifestation of white supremacy, as if to mystify it, as if there's some kind of like racialized Klansmen sitting beyond the bank and mortgage, you know, real estate development industry, saying, "Wahaha, we're going to move all these Black people out of these communities and have urban yuppies come in and take their property." When in reality, when you look at the basic fundamental functions of capitalism within the real estate market, the marketization of value demands that profitization and increase of value is going to always benefit those who have capitalized and have capital. And one of the realities of the systems of colonialism, racism, imperialism over time is that because those powers that were the seats of those exploitative enterprises were populated by European descended people, it's logical that European descended people will be the beneficiaries of those actual parasitic mechanisms. What happens in the United States is that the advent of deeming all of those European descended people that traditionally and normally would have been at each other's throats and had been throughout history, is that the gloss of whiteness as an operating mechanism to unify them is literally created in the United States in the 1600s, largely because of Bacon's rebellions and other rebellions in which poor whites and Blacks and Native Americans are unifying to challenge the ruling class to create this illusion. Whiteness is an American product. It really is. The notion and concept of whiteness is an American product. And I think that part of the problem of conflating whiteness with systems of capitalism, imperialism, and the other vehicles is that it renders the behavior to the pathological abstractions of a diseased people from Europe instead of a scientific system that also disadvantages those people from European background who are not of the class that are the beneficiaries and the orchestrators of how that system functions. Are you following what I'm saying, Dev? I don't want to feel like...
I mean, there's so much, as they say, to unpack. Rodrigo has a question. Rodrigo is our correspondent in Mexico. He comes on at the end of every show. And we have you on our show because of Rodrigo. And he wants, if we could make a minor detour out of respect for Rodrigo, to ask you this question, then come back to what you were talking about, because he wants to know how long it took Haiti to pay the reparations for liberating the slaves, which I think pretty much sums up what you just said. So give us a little back. Excuse me for 1 second, if you may. Contextualize this for us. Reparations. So when we talk, you've mentioned this before, and we've talked about this on the show.
Well, in the context that Rodrigo was talking about in the Haitian Revolution, after Haiti won its independence from France after vanquishing three empires, Spain, France, and Great Britain, in 1804, Haiti became an independent republic. But what happens is in 1825, in order to get recognition and have the capacity to trade with foreign powers, particularly France, Haiti is basically under the threat of return occupation by France, required to pay compensation to France for the vanquishing of France as a colonial empire in Haiti in gold bullion, in solid gold, for what in today's compensation would be equivalent of what would be about $23 billion. It takes Haiti from 1825 to 1947, a few years after my father was born, to pay this off. And it is a significant drain on the coffers of the country, and one of the major reasons why Haiti was basically pauperized after its independence to maintain its sovereignty as a country and avoid the possibility of having to confront the French as a colonial empire.
That's incredible. Up until 1947.
That's correct.
The French government was collecting reparations.
Yes, from Haiti.
From Haiti, because they could no longer own slaves.
Correct. They were no longer the colonial masters of the pre-revolutionary colony of Haiti.
But my father was supposed to storm the beaches of Normandy to free these people from the ravages of Hitler.
That's correct, yes.
Because we would hate... And Belgium, free Belgium from Hitler.
Well, the thing that's funny is that France went on to use the paradigm that it used in Haiti in many of its post-colonial African quote-unquote properties, if you will, and also required them after colonial independence in the 20th century to pay France reparations. Senegal, Benin, Dahomey, Mali, many of those countries still paid a compensatory compensation to France to this day, for the benefit of being colonized by the French and all the investment they did while they sucked, raped, and pillaged these African countries.
Have they ever figured out who was worse, King Leopold of Belgium or Hitler?
Leopold killed someone in excess of 10 billion people, I believe.
10 billion?
Million. 10 million.
10 million.
Yes.
King Leopold of Belgium, which... Yes. If the American people knew that in the lead up to World War II, that would be a hard sell. Well, no, actually, no, probably not.
The thing is, though, we're diverting into our subject matter, but one of the things that we realize is that in this particular era, we talk about critical race theory and people don't want to hear things about the ugly past of American history because they're going to, quote unquote, make white people ashamed. My goal in conveying this history is not to make white people feel evil. I don't want to impute guilt on you, David Feldman, because frankly, from what I know, you might have been a descendant of poor, underclass Jewish immigrants who were barely being able to survive in tenement houses in New York City.
I'm a direct descendant of Judah Benjamin, the Secretary of State for Jefferson Davis, in the Confederacy. I'm kidding. There was a Jewish secretary of the Confederacy, and I went, really? Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
But the goal that I'm trying to demonstrate is that I think is important to share these narratives is to understand that these nation states, all of them, are the product of the collusion of ruling classes of people which are trying to protect their interests in capital and wealth. And as someone who is a socialist or someone who uses Marxism as a tool to criticize capitalism, I want to share this issue to institutionalize in people's minds and instrumentalize the ability to criticize how the social hierarchies in our society are basically based on an extraction using violence and oppression to maintain the functionality of our systems, and that if we are acknowledging of that truth, we have the capacity to re-implement systems that are based on more humane, just, and equitable means of distribution that don't require so much, you know, rapacious extraction from individuals and suffering of human life.
In tackling white supremacy and critical race theory, is it necessary for all of us to learn about our own prejudices, our stubborn bigotry, to recognize that in all of us, these
big— That's a very good question, because I'm a little concerned about what I call the HRization of racial discourse. In other words, reducing racial conflict to how I feel about people, how I treat individually, because what happens is that you end up becoming an enterprise rooted in talking about how white people feel about other people and how Black people feel about other people. And we don't spend time talking about institutional mechanisms and structures in societies that are rooted in hierarchical means of extraction that are causing the requirements of these surplus members of society to be denied access to redistributive access of policy, wealth, and economic equity. So what I'm saying is that I do believe it's going to be difficult to try to base a society on a more equitable distribution of resources and goods and services if everyone's saying, I don't like Mexicans because those people are XYZ. I don't like Haitians because those people are XYZ. I don't like Italians. I don't like Germans. I don't like Jews. Obviously, at a basic level, we're going to have to dismantle the types of stereotypes, harms, and mechanisms that create those types of antagonisms within those individual groups. And we're going to have to deprogram away people away from that type of horrific type of, you know, stereotyping that causes that. But on a more larger or meta level, I think what's more important is to start at the top and talk about how the structures of our society, whether they be banking, finance, real estate, healthcare, education, higher education, universities, schools, institutions, marriage, divorce, childcare, are rooted in institutional mechanisms that promote a certain hierarchical system that have traditionally been not only so much about benefiting white men, because it wasn't just white men, it was white men of means who were property owners who were of a certain class.
Returning to gentrification, and how you're saying it's not a part of white supremacy. It's a
function. I don't want to say it's not a part of white supremacy. I'm saying it reducing it to white supremacy obscures the understanding of how capitalism is the mechanism that facilitates its operation.
So I grew up in the New York metropolitan area. When I was a kid, Harlem had its, you wanted to go to Harlem, but not certain parts of Harlem. And the more I went back to Harlem and continue to go back there, it's been gentrified, but by African Americans.
Correct. That's a very salient observation. People fail to realize, and one of the reasons why I don't like the racialization of these kind of mechanisms of economic extraction that also have racialized harm, is that it's very oftentimes that you can have Black people who are elites or a better economic or socioeconomic pedigree who are avid participants in the systems that disproportionately adversely affect poor and working class Black people. And that's actually one of the functions of what we talk about often on This Is Revolution podcast that we discuss on your show, the Black political class, how we actually have a cadre of Black elites who are pedigreed, educational, professional managerial class Blacks who go along and get along with the system, because the way in which American capitalism has worked is that they have been able to be quote unquote, integrated into will, if you will, into a functionality in the system. But yet, because American capitalism, with the rise of the fancy word of neoliberalism that we use, which is a fancy word for a form of privatization, if you will, is requiring larger numbers, not larger numbers, but numbers of poor and Black working class, larger numbers now, to be marginalized even more, they become beneficiaries of a system that people who are their racial kins in, so if you believe in such a thing as racial kinship, are suffering from, but at the same time use the charade of racial kinship to say, we are uplifting the race by being here in our gentrified Harlem that just kicked 6,000 people out of subsidized housing that's forcing them into subtenement housing, you know, homelessness, or maybe having to move down south to all kinds of horrible housing.
When Bill Clinton left the presidency, he put his office in Manhattan, in Harlem, I think either next door or across the street from the Apollo. And this was, you know, 22 years ago. Everybody said, wow, isn't that great?
Yep.
Oh, he hasn't forgotten his roots. He was America's first Black president, and he's propping up business in Harlem, not Midtown Manhattan. What does that say? The fact that Bill Clinton, where's the Clinton Foundation? Isn't that?
I don't know if the Clinton Foundation is headquartered in Harlem, but what it says is that Bill Clinton is a very shrewd understander and realizing that you can get a pretty good discount in real estate by investing in Harlem on the brink of it actually being able to skyrocket upward while being a facilitator of the same gentrification that you can profit from. Because one of the realizations people don't have is that people ask, well, what is the money that's in poor communities? Because if it's expensive to invest in a rich neighborhood, i.e. you need $500,000 to get a return on investment of 25%, if you can invest a dollar in a bad neighborhood but get a return on investment of 75%, it's a better investment. So sometimes in poor, disheveled communities, the investment is cheaper, but the ROI is higher.
The return on investment.
Exactly.
The return on investment.
The return on investment.
What could New York do? What it could do is do what I think France does. Pardon the, I don't think France is a role model in any way. Maybe in some ways it is. I was told that in France you can't build luxury apartments without those apartments also having low income.
Mixed use housing.
And do you believe that done properly could work?
I think mixed use housing can work. I think that we should stop believing that there are silver bullet solutions for these problems. And I think that we should address what's a fancy Marxist term. It's called ideological superstructure. We use it here a lot. What does that basically mean? The actual social mechanisms in our society, our social system, our healthcare system, our educational system, the value system that we permeate in terms of our lack of or fracturing family structures, the video games that kids play, the things that cause antisocial behavior, the things that cause people in urban environments to think that acting, behaving in antisocial ways and engaging in antisocial behavior that perpetuates crime, that helps facilitate capitalism's relegating them to surplus, should be removed from being internal mechanisms in our society, or else we're just going to be pouring money into things that change nothing. Because we have to find ways to change the structural means by which human beings interact in American society to disincentivize the behaviors that allow antisocial behavior that is oftentimes rendered criminal that disproportionately affects communities that are being harmed by this type of gentrification.
Well, I've been attacking complexity on this show since the beginning. I call it the complexity industrial complex. Hyper-educated people like yourself, you're a lawyer, yes. It's in your best interest for things to be more complex than they have to be. The shooting in Buffalo, I'm a reductionist. That was guns, in my estimation. When all is said and done, had, I maintain, I'd like you to respond to this, that white supremacy is stubborn in this country. As you say, we invented race to justify slavery. And but it's going to be hard to stop people from being white supremacists or hating Muslims or hating gays or hating Jews or hating women. We should work at that, but we should first and foremost make sure that nobody who thinks that way has ready access to an assault weapon. That's the that's the priority in my estimate. First and foremost is before we police people's thoughts, which I believe in, we first make sure they don't have access to guns.
I agree with that. I believe that there needs to be a qualitative form of gun control in American society. And I think that part of the thing I just talked about, ideological superstructure, is that we have a gun culture, if you will. I don't like to use the word gun culture. We have a gun fetishization in our society that is unhealthy.
What's going to happen? What would happen? We have to wrap it up. So please, I love you and I love having you on the show. And I've often said that if more and more Muslims dressed as Muslims and more Black people showed up at gun shows, we would have gun law in America. That if we could get more Black people dressing up like Black Panthers and walking around at gun shows and joining the NRA, suddenly the police chiefs would be saying, you know what? Maybe there should be an assault weapons ban. I'm now discovering Black Panthers are coming back. More and more African-Americans, at least the press is covering their open care, their concealed carry. What do you think about that? Is there any?
The thing is funny, historically though, what it's answered, the first time the NRA supported gun legislation was actually around the Black Panther Party in the 1960s in California. I'm sure you probably remember the name of the legislation. I forget the name. I think it starts with an H, but there was actually a legislation that was promoted in California to limit public open carry laws. And it was supported by the NRA directly as a consequence of the Black Panther Party.
And Reagan.
Yes, and Reagan, that's correct. So there is historical precedent to demonstrate the example that you put forth, that if African-Americans were to open carry any kind of militant, radical political posturing in opposition to, say, police homicide or things of that nature, that there would be very likely some type of blowback that the NRA might support in terms of gun regulation. So there is precedent for that.
There is. We have to wrap it up, but there is video on YouTube of Black Panthers patrolling Oakland and Berkeley. When they would drive around, they would wait for the police to pull somebody over, and then the Black Panthers would get out of the car, brandishing weapons, perfectly legal, and monitor the police, not with iPhones, right, with guns.
Right. By the way, there was the Mulford Act. Someone just put up the Mulford Act in 1967, which had banned carrying loaded weapons. That was the law. That was passed.
What is, before you go, what is the law regarding African Americans or any Americans showing up to a police stop, open carry, concealed carry? I mean, can you carry an assault weapon like Rittenhouse did?
When it's a state by state jurisdictional matter, and it depends on what the laws of the state are. I would guarantee you that in states in like New York, that's almost impossible because they are not open carry states. But in certain states, like maybe Texas or otherwise, it may be possible. But they may have municipal regulations that definitely adhere to determining whether or not those open carry laws allow you to carry a weapon so much in terms of proximity to a police stop or interrogation.
Yeah. Well, fascinating. I'm glad you're back. Pascal Robert is co-host of the This Is Revolution podcast. Follow them wherever fine podcasts are. And I'm glad you're back. It's really great to see you.
I appreciate being here with you.
Thank you. Thank you.